Hello everyone, it's Friday and you're watching Within the Frame. I'm Kim Bo-kyung. What's the latest in the culture sector? The revenge thriller The Glory starring actress Song Hye-kyo is proving its worldwide popularity by staying on top of the streamer's weekly viewership charts for 2 weeks in a row. On the movie front, Japanese animations are attracting many film lovers in South Korea, while Korean movies are posting quite sluggish results. Meanwhile, the fierce battle over the acquisition of SM Entertainment has ended as HYBE and Kakao reached a mutual agreement. What are the details? For an in-depth analysis of the culture sector today, we divided the segment into two parts. First, we welcome Jae So, a filmmaker and a professor at the Seoul Institute of the Arts. Professor So, welcome. It's great to see you.
Oh, it's nice to be here.
All right, Professor. First question. The Netflix revenge thriller series The Glory Part 2 remained top of the streamer's weekly viewership chart for the second consecutive week with more than 123 million viewing hours. What aspects of this drama are attracting so many viewers? I mean, what's so unique?
Well, you know, you have a revenge theme, and then you have the writer Kim Eun-suk, who wrote Mr. Sunshine, and you have Song Hye-kyo. So all the elements are there for a typical Korean drama. But the popularity has surprised me as well, because it's kind of a dark themed show. And as everybody knows, it's basically a 16 episode series. It's I guess last year December was the first part for 8 episodes, and then this month it started the other 8. And basically, it's a revenge story about student that was, you know, bullied 20 years ago that have come back to take revenge against all these people. And I think one of the most attractive things about it is the actress Song Hye-kyo, who we've known to be this beautiful actress that's done many sort of romantic leads in the past, has come back as kind of this revenge-seeking, you know, heroine that does all the stuff to avenge her the bullies that had bullied her 20 years ago. She comes out as an elementary school teacher, and I think, you know, all the supporting cast, you know, basically in the show also does it. The evil character of Im Dong-yeon, who is her nemesis in this, is so good. I was almost watching her more than Song Hye-kyo at times. But, this is an issue that Koreans are very familiar with, and I know it's really kind of hit a certain kind of nerve internationally with many people, because I think, you know, school bullying, you know, and then also revenge is something I think a lot of people sort of, identify with.
Right. I myself enjoy the show very much, too. I mean, the cast, storyline, they were all perfect. But Professor, the drama shed light upon school violence and negligence, mm-hmm. with the main protagonist seeking revenge, like you said, on the perpetrators. What are the spillover effects from this drama?
Well, you know, people are talking about The Glory more because I think in recent years, school violence has been one of the most serious social problems in Korea. As social networks have become more of a strong tool of raising public awareness, more victims have been coming forth. And, basically, they're talking about, like, freely on YouTube and things like that, you know, basically past violence that they have suffered. And also they are starting to come after the public figures. There have been, you know, famous actors that have had to apologize publicly for acts they've done. Also, this has spilled over to politics as well. Where recently, you know, basically a big politician who got a big post in the government, it turned out that his son was also a bully. So he ended up basically quitting the position. But, you know, these are things that I think Koreans are very much, it's in their zeitgeist, school bullying and bullying in general. So Glory has come to kind of bring all these dark sides of society into the forefront for a lot of people to discuss the issues, and also try to, you know, bring into, the forefront of trying to solve these kind of societal problems that we have. And I think what's interesting is that it's not just in Korea, but all around the world, you know, especially I think because we were, you know, all at home, you know, suffering from COVID, and then, you know, people are released back into where, you know, you're meeting people in person. I think all there are good things about that, but also sort of the bad things of, students bullying each other has come back. So I think now, because of social media, we're really coming to understand that these are, you know, things that are happening all over the world, and it needs to be kind of dealt with as a societal, you know, issue.
Right. So this drama not only had a great, impact on viewers regarding the storyline, but also it had great impact on social issues, like you said before. Professor, the foreign media too are reportedly very much fascinated by the revenge drama as well. And Forbes even recommended some other Korean dramas for those who would like to satisfy their craving for these kinds of revenge plus shows. How is the foreign media viewing this drama?
Well, I was looking at the internet on the online sites, and some of them were, there was like a one article that talked about how if you want to take revenge, you should watch K-dramas to get ideas. Because I think there's so much elaborate, intricate planning, it's very obsessive, and many of these K-dramas are, you know, basically about going back in the past to take revenge on things. So, you know, we've had, you know, recently, like, you know, the series like My Name was like another one that was big, Penthouse, Sky Castle, Vincenzo. It's becoming almost like a staple, even in K-dramas, where mostly it was sort of romantic sort of movies or comedies, or, you know, The Extraordinary Attorney Woo would be like another sort of a different kind of take on dramas. But I think revenge and things like that has always been sort of in dramas, and then especially in Korean movies recently with like Parasite and then Park Chan-wook's movies, you know, where revenge is sort of almost his genre in itself, that I think foreign or Western critics are really kind of seeing that as a very Korean thing. But, you know, it's something that I think it's exciting to watch. I think revenge is not just the Korean genre, but I think if you look at like the John Wick series or any of the Western movies, revenge is a prevalent theme that I think a lot of entertainment has always sort of like set aside for audiences to be really interested in.
Right. It's also very interesting, like you said, to see how the themes in Korean dramas are very diversifying. It's really good to see that. Professor So, moving on to the movie sector now, Japanese animated movies, including Suzume and, of course, the first Slam Dunk, were among the top five films on the weekend box office chart in South Korea. What's so special about these Japanese animated movies that are attracting these moviegoers?
I think what people fail to understand is that anime was really big in the 80s and 90s. It was also a wave, you know, the Japanese wave was actually anime in itself, but it's never really died down, and it's always been really strong. There are a lot of fan bases all over the world, and I think what's unusual is that it's doing well in Korea, that the two anime, you know, movies that have come out in the theaters have done well. Suzume is it depicts a high school girl and a mysterious young man trying to prevent a series of disasters, and I think this is like definitely a theme, I think, in Korea that could be very applicable to Koreans as well, and I think our cultures, Japan and Korea, are very similar in the way we look at things. So I think that also works. And then, you know, Slam Dunk, I've really enjoyed the, you know, the manga series. It started out as a comic, a Japanese comic called manga. In the 90s, there was an animation by Toei Animation that had this, but they released it now in the 21st century. And it just brings back for me a lot of nostalgia about basically a sports, anime where it's basically you have these kind of underdogs really trying to make it. And it's a theme that I think it really works now. And surprisingly, it's doing well in Korea as well.
Right, I see. But meanwhile, Professor, Korean movies, on the other hand, haven't performed that well recently, unfortunately. And according to the Korean Film Council, the ticket sales for Korean movies and audience shares in local theaters hit the lowest level for February since 2004, as far as I know, due to a lack of hit films, of course. What's behind the sluggish performance?
Well, again, it's like we had COVID happen, and then for a while, like, you know, I think last year when it started opening it up a little bit, you know, we had the Korean movie Roundup that did, you know, really good business. It was like over 10 million in ticket sales, but then all these movies started to really tank, and it didn't do that well. There have been like movies that are upwards of $20 million that have like failed at the box office, and it's just... I think audience members, it was a combination of when they came back from COVID, they're excited about it, but then there are all these factors like the ticket prices went up, basically. It was, you know, it was cheaper before COVID, and suddenly you come back and it's expensive. So I think people still are a little, you know, they'd rather watch it at home on their, you know, OTT channels rather than do that. And right now, you know, a lot of people don't know this, but there's about like 60 Korean films that have already finished. They've finished all the post-production. They're ready to release, but a lot of the production companies are just holding on to these films because they're afraid to release it and not really get the, you know, the ticket sales to back that up. So I think, you know, we need to show some more movies. We need to get more lineups to get people to the cinema. So I think, you know, we have these little flash in the pants with a few hits, but I think, you know, I think even this is a worldwide phenomenon, even in the US. I think it was like Paramount's Maverick, you know, the remake of the Tom Cruise thing did really well, and Avatar did well, but a lot of movies in America is not doing as well. So we have to kind of give it a little time, but I think people are going to come back to the theater eventually.
Right. I mean, of course, though we are temporarily seeing Korean movies' sluggish performance, I believe that there will be a backup after exciting Korean movies that are going to be released in April. What are they?
These are a couple. It's funny. There are sports movies coming up and a lot of comedies. So there's a movie called Rebound with director Jang Jun, who's a famous director actually from the Seoul Institute of the Arts, where I teach. He graduated there. But it's a kind of a sports movie about basketball, of all things. So it's kind of funny. It's dramatic, and it's a movie I'm really looking forward to. Also, there's a movie called Dream that stars IU and Park Seo Joon, and Park Seo Joon's from Parasite as well, and IU's a famous pop star herself. And that's a soccer comedy about a bunch of losers trying to make a team, and it's directed by Lee Byung-hun, who not the actor, but the director who directed Extreme Job, which was a huge hit. So he's a really proficient comedy director that's had a huge hit before, so we're looking forward to that. And then another comedy starring Lee Han-hee and Lee Seung-yoon from Parasite also. It's called Killing Romance, and that's a comedy as well about, you know, basically two people that are really not meant for each other. So not too many movies coming up, but I think it's a change of pace to have comedies and sports movies coming out. So I'm really looking forward to it being a box office, you know, hit for the audiences in Korea.
Right. I myself will also be looking forward to those exciting movies to come up. All right. That was Professor So from Seoul Institute of the Arts talking about the K-drama and movie sectors. Professor So, thank you for your insights. We really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
And shifting gears a bit to take a look at how the fierce battle between Kakao and HYBE to acquire SM Entertainment came to an end. The intensified battle came to a dramatic deal as HYBE decided to halt the SM Entertainment takeover bid and instead seek platform cooperation with Kakao. And for this, we invite Kim Young-dae, music critic and ethnomusicologist, on the line. Hello, Young-dae. Welcome to the show.
Good evening.
Now, Young-dae, reportedly, a mutual decision was reached on Sunday. Could you briefly give us details on how the battle developed and the decision they made?
Well, that's very complicated. I mean, so it was all started as initial, like, dispute between, you know, former producer and, you know, the biggest shareholder and, you know, obviously the founder of SM Entertainment, Lee Soo-man, and the current CEO, Lee Seung-soo, as SM Entertainment started to envision a kind of new you know, company project. It's called SM 3.0. It's basically a new SM without Lee Soo-man's control over many things. So then, you know, Kakao came in. You know, at the time, nobody actually had a clear idea about what that is. You know, SM initially, you know, said that it was more of a kind of business, kind of strategic partnership between SM and Kakao. But people outside started to believe that that's actually the real intention for Kakao was to acquire SM. Then, as a sort of a kind of counterattack move, you know, HYBE all of a sudden, you know, purchased almost 15% of SM Entertainment shares from former producer Lee Soo-man. Well, to put it differently, Lee Soo-man, you know, sold his shares to HYBE as a sort of, you know, the counterattack. They were having a kind of fierce battle, like you mentioned, between HYBE and Kakao. Initially, we all believed that Kakao would be just acquiring SM without any difficulties, but that the market, outside market, you know, started to believe that this will be a competition of money. Then Kakao And HYBE on March 12th, I believe, had a kind of business agreement. And before that, Kakao proceeded with a tender offer at the big money. And then the HYBE and SM had an agreement. And I think the latest news was that the HYBE labels, they announced that they will discontinue the acquisition process. Then finally, today, HYBE sold off almost 20% of SM Entertainment shares to Kakao at almost $400 million US dollars, participating in this public takeover bid. To put it simply, Kakao won the battle, and Isuman, SM, and HYBE, all these players had their money in a way.
Right, Dangde. Thank you for your explanation over how the fierce battle developed. I mean, the biggest question here is why HYBE backed out, you know? What was the main reason? And what other opportunities do you believe HYBE will be on the lookout for in the future?
Yeah, I mean, for HYBE, was good investment. I mean, good kind of adventurous move to acquire SM because, I mean, SM, obviously, the third biggest company, probably the most kind of the rich, you know, source in K-pop IP in many different ways. So for HYBE, definitely SM is a kind of valuable asset. But I think obviously was the price was way higher, you know, throughout this battle, was way higher than they originally expected. So they made a wise decision, you know, that they observed a market kind of the situation, and they definitely found this was a bit of overheating, you know, situation because of the competition with Kakao and Kakao Entertainment. So they decided not to go ahead with this acquisition process because for them it was not necessarily kind of win-win battle. You know, with the proper you know price, it would be. But with this amount of money and overheating situation, it would be maybe lose for them. So that's why I think they made this kind of decision.
Right. So thus, Kakao eventually ended up acquiring the SM Entertainment, and SM Entertainment announced that it will accelerate its Vision 3.0 strategy. Could you elaborate on this new vision? I mean, how it is different from previous strategies made by SM Entertainment, and what you expect from it?
Yeah, another complicated issue. But ultimately, the key here is that this is kind of blueprint for SM. Without Isuman, I think that's the big thing. I mean, they made a lot of like a kind of detailed information announcement, but I think the biggest issue here is that they trying to build a company again without Isuman. First of all, the most important change is the music production. You know, which had been completely dependent on a sort of like a centralized system. You know, namely Isuman, right? He's an imperial producer. You know, he made all this like aesthetics and the music system before, but that they tried to converting this to a sort of multi-production centers, you know, not just one person, but the multi-production centers and multi-labels with a lot of different personnel for a different project. So they had this, you know, the vision that they had tried to have more, you know, competitive music system through this formation of different professional talents for each genre, each singer to compete the music giant company like HYBE and JYP. This is not a completely new situation because in the end, the important thing is how to disperse the power that was formerly concentrated in Isuman in the past. So they tried to run the company with a lower risk, right? But Isuman, operated, formally operated his own publishing company, and then cooperated with SM through his own company. But according to 3.0 plan, SM will have their own publishing company, and try to make music through the company to enter a overseas market through it.
Right, I see. Since we are running out of time, Yongde, I think this could be our last question. But
sure.
HYBE announced that it reached an agreement to cooperate on matters related to companies' platforms between Kakao and HYBE. Those specifics are yet to be revealed. How did it work out, in your opinion?
It was not revealed. I wish I knew about it. No one has a clear picture about it yet. But the easiest product prediction would be, you know, it is HYBE's own strategy to secure the artists, you know, from SM or Kakao through their own platform, Weverse. I think that that's the biggest intention here, because I mean, right now, this HYBE is not just a music company, but it's more of an IP and you know, the IT or the platform company, and the Weverse might be the biggest asset they currently have. Details are not known yet, but in the end, I think the future of the company HYBE is dreaming right now is not just success as a music label, but kind of leaping into a influential media company in the end. So it is highly likely that HYBE might obtain a I don't know, but maybe HYBE obtained a guarantee, you know, from Kakao and SM for Weaver's role here, you know, instead of giving up a, you know, management right.
Right, interesting. We'll just have to wait and see how it goes
sure.
on, right? Unfortunately, this is all the time we have for today's edition, but thank you, Yongde, for your insights. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
This is all for Within the Frame tonight. We will be next Monday with more in-depth stories. Thank you for watching. Enjoy the weekend and goodbye.